Khalifa Sala, the Nam for Seregunda, is the man on the checkpoint. Ablai C went to meet him. For more, follow this special encounter.
Honorable Khalifa Sala, National Assembly Member for Seregunda, welcome to the checkpoint.
Thank you very much.
First things first, Honorable Sala, you are one of the guys who did absolutely well in trying to bring a regime king to the Gambia 10 months ago. But you never took a cabinet position. Why?
I remember meeting the Inspector General of Police in his office because of the absence of a law protecting the president-elect. And I told him that, look at me, I'm not even going to be a beneficiary of this change. I would not even be holding a ministerial post. But you will need your integrity to be protected.
You mean the former Inspector General?
Yes, by supporting what the Constitution dictates. And if you do abide by the constitutional dictates, then it's the duty of your security force to protect the president-elect. Why did I do that? That is to show that selflessness is the basis of people coming together and keeping people together. So, to answer your question, this is a transitional administration. When, as a presidential candidate, I called the other five presidential candidates to discuss at Cairo Beach, none of us knew who was going to be the presidential candidate of a coalition or whether even a coalition will be formed.
But in short, why didn't you take a cabinet position?
Well, I am emphasizing that why didn't I also say I must be the presidential candidate? It's still showing an element of selflessness, because the issue was, if you have a transition, do you need seven presidential aspirants to be part of a cabinet?
May I ever approach?
Well, my thinking before, and I think you should ask President Barrow that, which post would have given me if I was interested.
There are rumors that you were tipped to be the vice president. Is that so?
Well, I think I've already answered your question. I said you must ask President Barrow.
Yeah, but it involves you personally. Can you clarify that it was, or it did happen, or it didn't? You were never approached to be...
Just listen to my answer. I am saying you should ask President Barrow which post he would have given me. But I believe that he never entertained that in his mind because of my mannerism.
So that implied he never approached you to be vice president?
I am saying I believe he has not even seen, because you know that President Barrow, when he was asked that question in Dakar, he said he was going to have a woman as a vice president. I think everybody knew what was in his mind. But I'm trying to explain a situation for you which created a relation of integrity between me and the president. I don't believe the president ever read in me the desire that I wanted a particular position from him. That was my interpretation, that he sees that this person is serving and wants us to succeed, but not that he was looking for a particular post. Because if I was interested in a vice presidential position and he gave it to somebody else, you would have a crisis in the cabinet and crisis in the society, because many people would have said, look at the role that Khalifa has played, that Barrow has betrayed. So I've been engaged in a lot of damage control, and I've been very sensitive to the situation of the country in answering this question. That is why I answered it by accepting almost what some people are saying, that he does not want to be. Instead of saying, let's appreciate this man's position, that he has put everybody together. Now there is a transition. A transition, you don't need everybody to be in it.
But Honorable Sala, yes, if everyone said they are so selfless that they wouldn't serve in the transitional government, there will be no transitional government.
And if there is no transitional government, you will have technocrats in that transitional government, not politicians. You people must bear in mind that maybe that would have in fact been the best thing for all political figures to say, well, we have a future aim to lead this country. So now let's allow the transition to be held by technocrats, people who have no aim to become a president or to assume.
So that implies you still want to be president of this country?
Implication, I think, is a wrong word. I was a presidential candidate. And because I was a presidential candidate, we, six presidential candidates, agreed that we'll put the national interests before our partisan interests. On the 17th of October, we agreed to sign an agreement that we will hold a convention on the 30th of October. And that convention, whoever is elected will receive our support. And that's precisely what I did as a presidential candidate. Even though the assumption was I called this presidential candidate so that I will be informed. But everybody eventually saw that even though I said I would have led a two-year transition, when a person was selected, I accepted that mandate. And not only that, we went to the forefront to ensure that within my capacity, that person carries the day.
Okay, excellent. I'm just coming to the right now. Like, the arrangement between the coalition members was a three-year transition period.
Yes.
Now some other people are saying they have to obey or abide by the constitution and going for a five-year term. What is your take?
Well, the constitution has many provisions. There's a provision for resignation, which reduces your term. There's a provision to be impeached, even for infirmity or for misconduct. So the constitution has many provisions. When we met, six people had interest in a position. How do we have one? Well, we have to negotiate. And in that negotiation, we said, for 52 years, Gambia had never changed to the ballot box. Let's give Gambia a new start. Let's prove that we, the six people, were not power hungry. Let's agree that among us, whoever wins will serve only for 3 years. That is not your term, even though it's your term for 5 years. Like now, President Barry can say, no, I will not be there for 3 years, I will stand for 5 years. Constitutionally, nobody can challenge him. So that is the reality. But we agree that let's cut the term so that we show the Gambian people that this person who is now coming is a transitional figure, is not interested in power. And that person will also not participate in the next following election. And the person will stand as an independent candidate. Well, President Barro stood as an independent candidate.
Are you foreseeing that happening?
Well, I don't think people often really understand what is being said. This is not about expectation. It is not, in fact, a demand. It is an act of integrity in helping the country to have a new start. So whether he does it or not, for me, it does not really matter.
What matters?
What matters simply is we came together in the spirit of putting an end to self-perpetuating rule and agreeing that the first person who wins will put out this mandate to prove to the Gambian people and the world at large that this coalition did what they did to give Gambia a new start, not to put somebody in office, not to put a party in office. That's why we said, you know, the person will be an independent candidate and not to participate in the next following election, which means that gives the person moral authority to preside over a nation where election is coming, all the rules will be followed, all the electoral laws that will govern free and fair election will be there. The media will be open to diverging views, dissenting opinion, which means under the mandate of that person, the good governance we call for, the human rights we call for, respect for fundamental rights we call for, the rule of law that we want, and democracy that we want to consolidate will be consolidated. That is what is called regime change. We felt that democracy was an assault, rule of law was dishonored, respect for human rights was in tatters, and that in actual fact good governance was not the order of the day. So we said that is what needed to change. Because we said it needed to change, that the regime change is precisely about that. It's about constitutional reform. It's about legal electoral reform. It is institutional reform. It is normative reform in administration, so that now you, when we go to the hospital, to the schools, or any educational institution, we deal with the police, the army, we'll be meeting a new Gambian.
Okay, we'll get details into that. Like, what is your response? You said you didn't take a cabinet post because of your selflessness. What does have a reverse opinion, that you are trying to reposition yourself for the next elections? That's why you are not interested in the transition.
There is nothing wrong with that interpretation, and I will not challenge that interpretation. What I'm saying is, people don't have to respect my opinion. But what I'm trying to say, look at my practice. What position would President Barra have given me? Would he have given me a vice president's position when he has already said in Dakar he's a woman who would be a vice president?
But you can be.
We are coming. Now, how would people have interpreted President Barrow if, after the role I have played, he did not give me the position that they feel that I deserve? He will be blaming President Barrow today that he has betrayed Khalifa Sall. But it is good that I would prefer to be blamed than for President Barrow to be blamed, because I had no ambition for this position, and I don't think he can ever betray me, because I am really not interested in being paid for the services I have rendered. So if people feel that I'm repositioning myself, well, clearly, well, that's their opinion. But I know one fundamental thing is clear. On the 25th of December, President Barrow addressed the nation and said that Agency for Sustainable Socio-Economic Development will be created, a think tank, an expert bank. And I had volunteered at that time to head that agency temporarily in order to give the administration a new start. And the mandate of that institution was that on the 14th of January, before he assumes office, a skeletal development blueprint will be presented to a shadow cabinet, so that ultimately, when a cabinet is formed on the 19th, they'll be working on that principle. So for me, from the start, I've worked with the coalition, we formed it, all the instruments prepared, we campaigned together, we raised the banner of one Gambia, one nation, one people, because insults from the angle of the executive led to reaction from the angle of the opposition. We said, well, the executive has executive power. Many people will still support him, regardless of the insult. But if we start insulting each other, we will be fractured.
I'm coming right now. The recent media misunderstanding between you and the state, like you are alleged to have said outside during your European tour that there is a regime change but no system change. And I understand you said you didn't say that. And
no, no, no. Don't put words in my mouth. It is not about saying or not saying.
Did you say that?
Well, I have explained very clearly that we are in the process of the aftermath of regime change. And the task of this government is not to put more in its mouth than it can chew. What it is mandated to do is regime change. This change of bad governance into good governance, abrogation of democracy into institutionalization of democracy, this respect for rule of law to respect for rule of law.
Yes, you are saying
that is what you call regime change.
Yes, let me just clarify. The state responded through a press release read on GRTS, and you organized a press conference going against that.
Yes.
Now,
the same people respond to me.
Yeah, I'm coming. You are a presidential advisor.
Yes.
Wouldn't it have been better for you to solve this internally rather than going to the media?
Well, I think you should understand the context of my discussion, and I hope everybody in the Gambia will start putting things in its proper context. I stood for election. How did you refer me? You refer me to a member for Serekunda. So something has changed in this country. And which party did I stand for? I didn't stand for a coalition. I stood for
Yes.
So I don't know what is wrong with the Gambian people when they analyze now what has gone wrong with them. I believe they should see the transition that has taken place. I'm the Secretary General of a political party, invited by the members of my political party to address them in London. and telling them about the current situation. The current situation, there has been regime change, and we expect a three-year period for this government, and then we should prepare for system change.
I understand. What I'm saying is, your response through the media, I'm saying, do you not think it would have been better for it to be internal, considering you are in more than one heart? You are a National Assembly member voted in by the people. At the same time, you are a presidential advisor.
I believe you must understand. Maybe that's what you want me to clarify. I can now understand your question. Well, I was initially appointed, but that appointment was not accepted in principle of being an executive presidential advisor. Because to be an executive presidential advisor, you are actually a public officer. You know, and it means that you are under the jurisdiction of the executive. I felt that being paid to advise the president is not the best role that Khalifa Saleh can play. So that position was not accepted. The position that I advance is that I'm a voluntary advisor. Whenever the president needs me, I will go within seconds and minutes to answer him. And whenever I see that something needs to be said, that will be said. But it's important for you to understand the context of my meeting in London. I met our party members and then met the community of Gambians. And my purpose was to encourage them to see the change as our collective property, not the change of the president, not the change of National Assembly.
So I'm trying to say, your comments were taken out of context.
Well, even that, I don't want to go into that far. I'm just simply saying, a journalist wrote and they responded to a journalist and then put my name there. I'm saying, looking when I saw the press release, what I said is that it was not signed by anybody. It was not dated. So I don't take that as a serious press release. In fact, I'm raising queries about it. And the name of a person was mentioned who is in the public service. And under section 222 of the Constitution, no public servant should utter any statement that is prejudicial to the rights of anybody. No public servant should utter any statement as if the person is taking the side of a group, either from a nepotistic or on the basis of favoritism. So all the provisions are there, so which have been breached, and therefore I'm taking up issue with that. I'm simply saying that the public was misled. In fact, what I'll be doing, I'll be publishing the email that I am receiving from the radio stations, who said that the appreciation of their listeners of what I said, and they are ready to come to invest in the Gambia. So I think what they have done for me,
I will still come back to these things. So obviously, an internal arrangement would not have been better.
No.
The media is the solution.
No. It's not about media. I was talking to a community of Gambians and friends of the Gambia.
Your reaction to the press release. That's what I'm saying.
Press release, as I said, it was best in order to deal with the situation in terms of the media by virtue of the fact that nobody signed it. Since nobody signed it, then it is to expose the issue because they already made it a public issue. It was already in the media behind me. And my integrity was being questioned when I was doing the work that everybody outside appreciated, that it was helping the Gambians to understand the processes that had been started. People, for example, questioned about what was being thought about the Constitution. I told them that at the National Assembly, the minister came and told us that he's bringing a bill which is designed to establish a constitutional review commission. And then we are telling the minister, what about, because some people are saying, you went and changed only 65 years, what about the urgent orders? And we said, we've raised that with the minister. He said, if there are any urgent constitutional reforms, they are willing to consider it. So in a way, I was giving them update as to what was happening. Of course, I also told them, still 72 hours, some people are detained without being taken before a court, and those type of actions should be stopped. So in short, a balanced perspective was being given, but telling them that they should not anticipate that in 3 years, this government is going to give jobs to the 400,000 young people who come out of our school system every 12 years.
Okay, these comments that you're making in public, are you passing that to the government, as you said, as a volunteer observer?
Well, you see, the passing of information comes in many forms. As a National Assembly member, you have seen our QAs, question and answers. That gives information to government to be able to...
Yeah, but in a, at a confidential level, as a voluntary advisor, do you?
Well, you know, you cannot go on the public space and say, I am simply telling you, whenever I see something of concern, yes, I do take the initiative.
Okay, very good. We come to the National Assembly. Recently, National Assembly members were given vehicles, and we understand that you didn't take any. Why?
Why do you simply affirm that you did not take any? I think that should be a question. So it's like you have. So we are saying the subject of not taking has not arisen because of procedural lapses. We are simply saying under section 222 of the Constitution, under the financial provisions, issues of gift to public officers are of concern. So therefore, if you're a National Assembly member, if you're a minister, if you're part of the executive, if you're holding, you know, public office, or you are being paid from the consolidated fund, even if the issue of public office is not well defined in the Constitution, then you must accept those code of conduct in guiding you.
So in principle, you are okay with the gift. The thing is, the procedures, right procedures were not followed.
We are saying we don't even know whether it is a gift. We are saying...
Have you ever accepted anything from the government?
Okay. Well, why don't we clarify this?
I will link it to that.
So we clarify this. So if we look at the situation now, is that if something is coming from the executive to the National Assembly, a letter should be written, accepted, stating the condition. This is being provided on these conditions. It's a gift. Is something this, that, so that, how do you manage it, how do you maintain it? So when that is transmitted to the National Assembly, you respond. And you sign and you accept by those conditions.
Yeah, that's clear. Yeah. What I'm saying now.
So that has not been done. Yes. So we don't know whether even something arises. So it's not about we accept or we reject. Yes. You say, have we ever accepted?
Yes.
Why don't you become more specific? Because some people have asked me about what has been given to the coalition in terms of transport. Is that what you're talking about?
Not the coalition.
No, for me, I've never. How can I receive anything from a government? I think I've always been serving. Even when I was minority leader, you know, for me, go to the National Parliament and you find out that they gave vouchers, fuel vouchers. I was minority leader. When I finished my term in the National Assembly, I returned all those fuel vouchers. I had never used it. It's wrong to use it, but I did not. Do you know that all National Assembly members were given compounds? They were given land? I never took land. Even though it was my right, there's nothing wrong with it for people taking it. But I never took that.
So it's a long-standing principle of yours.
Well, that's a personal, that's not a dirty thing. I'm just simply saying, in terms of certain things, those are personal principles. But this one is not about personal principles. We are saying simply the procedure has not led to a situation where we know that something is available and the conditions surrounding that very thing. That has not arisen.
Good. We're running out of time, but we won't end this without I asking you about your political party, PDRS.
Yes.
After the PVP and NCP, I think now you are the oldest party.
Yes.
And it seems as new parties come and beat you in elections, they get more votes. Like NRP came and found you in the game, they got more. GDC, technically, we can say they got more, though you didn't contest as independent party this time round. What is the problem with PDRS? Are you not communicating well?
Well, we've shown PDRS in the First Republic, and you've seen that a coup d'etat occurred. We were offered ministerial posts, I think you know that, we didn't accept it. And we pushed the conflict that we must go to democratic constitutional rule. That is the work of PDRS. That shows our strength. We said, coup makers, you must move to democratic constitutional rule when no single party made a pronouncement.
But why are new parties getting more votes?
Yes, I'm answering. But we moved to democratic constitutional rule. We emerged. And a new constitution came into being. Some were calling it a soldier's constitution. If you even though decrees were supreme to constitution.
Still we come to this, why are new parties meeting?
Yes, we reverse it to constitution. So Doyle was pushing, and then NAD we push. 2016 we helped this country to effect the first democratic change in its history. That is the work of Doyle.
Why are new parties meeting you?
Because Doyle has been working on the foundation that democracy is inconceivable without the sovereignty of the people. So our task has not been focused on winning seats in the National Assembly. It has been focused on changing minds, because we know that once the Gambian people know who they are, know what they own, then they will be able to entrust it to people who will ensure that they don't live in poverty and die in poverty. So it has been a work of building a people so that those people will entrust responsibility.
Honorable Ali Fasala, thank you very much for being on the checkpoint. Thank you.
Thank you.
Thank you. All right.